everybody. Thanks for coming. This is my first time here. So I am trying to be a presenter right away and participate. But I want to ask that you all participate right away. If you're willing to stand up, you don't have to, but I would like you to stand up and do a little body movement with me real quick. Just to like refresh your brain state. So we're just going to like move your body back and forth, and your legs, get the blood pumping. There is a purpose to this. This will help you concentrate through lunchtime. That's kind of cool. All right. Okay, you can stay standing a little bit, or you can sit down. So I want to ask before I get started from a few of you, what brought you to this presentation? Like, what got you interested in the title? What maybe are you hoping to get out of it? Don't all talk at once. Yes.
So I just realized how much admiring self-doubt kind of is a barrier professionally. I'm always looking to find ways to help overcome.
Okay, self-doubt. That's a good one. And thank you for sharing that, because that's actually something people struggle more, way more with than they would ever admit to. Okay, anyone else? Okay, that's good.
Some personal changes can help with the scale of things that work personal and professional.
Okay, that's good. Anyone else?
This just triggered on a pattern that I noticed in my past that's kind of what's happened is that sometimes before I can grow, I need to spend more time on my own self. And then I grow a little bit, and so on. I just recognize that as a pattern that I hadn't recognized before, so I'm just...
Hopefully you've come to the right session then. And really special sweater you have going on.
Yeah, it says, "Hello, summer." When I was at Target last night, it's like, that. I need that in my life.
That's awesome. Okay, anyone else? What got you interested or what you hope to
get
out of it?
Well, I was told that I kind of remind myself, growth and comfort do not coexist and be successful.
Yeah. Growth and comfort.
And that was, I think, from a CEO of a major company that I said, I would like to organize that.
I really like that. I actually, by nature or nurture, or however it happened, I don't love conflict, but I soon learned in life that because I love growth so much, that you can't grow unless you can actually work through conflict. So, okay, any last takers for?
I just found myself on this path of just starting my own startup, and what I realized is I'm also on this path to just discovering more about myself, because my previous job, it's no longer there. I mean, it's no longer, that phase doesn't exist. And so, I mean, it's going to sound weird, but I felt like just the universe was like, all right, this is a session you have to go to. And I think the quote for me is always, all power lies within. And for me, that's, and again, learning more, expand, keeping an open mind to what that might be, because everyone is on a different path and a different journey. So.
That's really good. Thanks for sharing. All right, so first a little bit about my background. So my background is a therapist, and I've been in the field for about 10 years. And really my interest, I worked with a lot of different things. I did in-home therapy with kids and their families. I worked in private practice working with all sorts of anxiety, depression, couples. I worked with a lot of complex trauma, people coming out of all sorts of abuse, spiritual abuse and manipulation. And I got to work with some of the best in the area in understanding the neurology of trauma and how people get stuck in their brain and patterns and how you can kind of get unstuck out of that. And before I was ever in kind of the business world, I didn't know of the concept scaling, but I always had the thought like, I'm getting to work with one person, 1 hour at a time, and I'm seeing a lot of progress and impact, but this information is so helpful. How can this actually scale? How can more people hear this? Because this is helpful to everybody. So even, for example, for me talking in this room, this is like a lot of you get to hear this at once, and I'm really excited about that. The other thing, how I transitioned into the marketplace. So currently, I do kind of individualized consulting with founders and CEOs and kind of do team culture, healthy leadership development stuff. And my heart behind that was what I would see in my field is, whether it was the head of a family, a business, an organization, whatever the issues were at the top always flowed down to everyone underneath. And so my interest was, if you can get someone healthy on the inside that's leading something or in a position of leadership, then that will automatically cascade down. So this is a concept that I am building out and I've seen have a lot of impact with a lot of the leaders and founders that I'm working with now. And so I want to talk about it a little and then give really a foundational paradigm that I think will be really helpful and something that I've actually seen to be life-changing for everyone who's heard it, and it's very simple. So I only have two slides. They're just kind of background visuals to help. But basically, a lot of you touched on it, why you're coming to this, but scaling within is actually, everyone is hoping to scale and grow, and but you can't really do that unless you expand your internal capacity to do that. And a lot of times, the conditions that help you start something will actually kill you if you don't adjust. Which is also true in psychology. Like, a lot of times they call it defense mechanisms, or they were things that when you were younger you learned to do to survive when you had to, and they were really useful. But once you outgrow that, if you keep doing those same things when you're in a healthy environment or a different stage in life, those very things that helped you will kill you kind of from going forward in a healthy way. So part of this is pausing wherever you are in your process, whether you're starting a new venture, you're working for a startup, you're thinking about something, is how do I stand back and kind of look at what's happening on the inside and where I'm at in my process? Because if you, kind of the main point of this is acting from intention rather than reaction. If you're not aware of what's going on, you're going to ensure that you act out of old patterns over and over. So there's a lot of people working really hard and spinning their wheels, but they're not actually going anywhere. It's kind of a weird picture, but I'm thinking of a chicken with its head cut off. Like, you face a blow, your head gets cut off, you might be running around the yard, still running from the muscle memory of what you've done before, but you're not actually going anywhere. So this is a chance to pause and see where you're going next. Okay, so this is kind of the main thing I want to teach on, and I'm really excited about this, and it's what I've seen a lot of people use this and grow from a lot. So this comes from the field of neurobiology, and it's something that's kind of housed right now in the trauma world that's really useful, but it's not really out beyond that field very much. So this is called the window of tolerance. Everyone has one. The goal is to be in your window, in that middle zone. When you're connected to your window, you're operating from the most wise, kind part of yourself. It's when you're clear-minded, you can see the forest from the trees, you know where you're at and how to move forward. This is kind of like your optimal zone. So even if you just stop for a second and think of times in life when you felt most connected or most like, I'm talking and people care about what I'm saying and I'm in my element and everything is working, that's kind of getting connected to that place. It's kind of being connected to the present, but also your future desired state at the same time and drawing from that into the now. So people can go out of their window in one of two directions. So if you bump up into hyperarousal, that's when you start to feel more anxious or you have more like fast beating heart, more hypervigilance, which is being hyper aware of everything. You're acting really fast. You just want symptom relief, like, oh, I got that email that stirred all these things up inside of me and I just need to respond to that real quick. A lot of business executives live their whole life operating from that place, which is not actually ideal because it's a fight or flight response. When you're in that mode, you're operating out of fight or flight. People can also drop out the bottom and go into hypoarousal. And when you do that, you kind of go into a shutdown mode. It's more depressive type symptoms. It's more numb, feeling shut off from the world, not really feeling anything. Curious if any of you can relate to any of those things at all.
Like hyperarousal, anxiety, depression.
Yes, and for some people, they'll bump out and go so high up that they can't sustain that, but then they'll drop out the bottom.
One of the things I've been trying to do is like, doing my gut
So you're asking when you are tuning into your gut, and and what are you noticing?
So if you like, you start having some discomfort, right? I'm not quite sure about this. There's something about it I don't like. Is it? Are you feeling those stages outside of your comfort zone? Is that giving you that discomfort, or is that different?
So hopefully I'll go into that a little more, because what I'm going to talk about is how to begin to notice and tune into what's happening on the inside. It could be you could be out there, but if you're noticing it, you're probably catching yourself when you're starting to climb up and not fully there yet, depending on the situation. Any other questions or thoughts right away?
So that's self-awareness then? Is that, I mean, what you were saying is just catching yourself, so which we want to be one present, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And that's exactly what I'll be talking a lot more about. So, but just a few more things about this. Why it's so important to stay in your window is because when you're in your window, you're connected. This is where a little bit of nerdy psychology stuff comes in. But this is when you're in your window, you're connected to your prefrontal cortex. And that's a part of your brain that's not fully developed till around 26, they say, which is kind of fascinating to think about kids having kids generation after generation and not really being fully developed in their brain. So that's when you're able to see from a higher perspective, have clarity about where you are and where you want to go. And if you bump into hyperarousal, you go into fight or flight, that part of your brain shuts down. It's kind of like how if you're walking down the street and someone starts chasing you, your prefrontal cortex shuts down. It's the time to go into fight or flight. It's not the time to figure out and process what their intentions might be. It's the time to get out of there. But if you're in a work situation, you don't really want to go into that state. You want to be connected to your higher thinking.
Question. Is it part of what you're talking about, trying to raise that hyperarousal bar so that you don't end up in that anxiety state, or is it really to somehow limit what you're doing so that you don't hit that?
Yeah, so the goal is to stay in your window. Some people have big windows and they're mostly in there, and some people might have a really small window and they're mostly never experienced what it's like to operate from a rooted, grounded place. So if that's the case, you want to begin to stretch that over time. But this is just setting up the base, but basically the number one goal is to recognize if you're in your window, because if you're not in your window, you want to get back in. As much as possible, you don't want to come to any conclusions or make any decisions if you're not in your window. And how I kind of think of that is in school growing up, we did fire safety and they would tell us to stop, drop, and roll. If I can recognize that I'm not in my window, I'm gonna try to stop, drop, and roll. And by that I mean I'm gonna stay low to the ground and not think everything that I'm thinking. Just kind of a novel thought, but you actually don't have to think everything you're thinking. Not every thought you that comes through your head, you have to own and work through. I love processing things and analyzing things, and I used to think that I actually had to think through every thought that came to my head, and it's actually not helpful. If you're in your window, it is. If you're not, it's not. I like to kind of use extreme examples sometimes because it helps get the idea, but when I would work with complex trauma clients, if they were to come in and process through past trauma that was really heavy, hard, difficult things, and they were in their window, we could actually work through it and they could get healing and move forward. But if they came in and they were so dysregulated and they were out of their window, if we were to talk through that past trauma, it would only re-imprint the trauma in their brain and make it worse. So this is why it's really important to be aware of this, not only for yourself, but if you begin to think about interactions with coworkers, loved ones, if one or both of you are not in your window, it's probably not going to end productively. So even right now, if you can think about a loved one or a coworker or something in situations where you've had to work through conflict and you talked through hard stuff, but it went well and you were able to work through it and grow, versus same person, different day, you talk about something and it completely blows up in your face, chances are either you or them were out of your window. Something got triggered. When that happens, actually, that higher thinking shuts down and you're accessing a younger part of your brain. You only have access to the part of your brain when that kind of trauma is imprinted. And when I say trauma, that's kind of a big word, but that can mean either a big thing that happened to a person or it can be just the little small, little T traumas, they call it, that happen over life that kind of shape us or give us the self-doubt, like you mentioned, or things like that. So really important to be in there as much as possible. Oh, one other thing about as much as possible, don't come to any conclusions or make any decisions. So how I think about it is sometimes like my thoughts are a house, or I'm inside of my house and I'm aware of all these thoughts knocking on my door. They could be all these different negative thoughts or things that would take me down different spirals. Another part of hyperarousal, they say catastrophic thinking. That's the kind of thinking that one thought starts and then you say, then this will happen, and this will happen, then I'll lose my job, and I'll never get married, and I'll never have kids, or blah, blah, blah. It just spirals out of control. So how to prevent that? If you have awareness and you're aware of those thoughts knocking, you are the one that gets to choose whether you're letting them in or not. That's what I mean by you don't have to think everything you're thinking. Just because it comes to you doesn't mean you have to accept it in. You can actually stop and not, you don't have to bring it to the next level. You can pause. How many of you have heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs before? Okay, so this is how I think about this. If I'm not in my window, it's not the time to self-actualize. It's like, really not. But usually that's what people do. Like, what am I doing with my life? What? I'm going to be a failure forever. Wherever your mind spins, if you're not in your window, it's not the time to think about that, because you're actually not accessing very much of your brain. You're in a fight or flight response. You're in a trauma brain state. So if I can recognize that I'm not in my window, I'm just going to focus on my basic needs. I'm going to stay low to the ground. That's what I mean by stop, drop, and roll. I'm not going to engage in higher thinking right now. I'm just going to take care of that. And I'll talk more about that, how to do that. You all know what it's like when you're seeing from a higher perspective and you're feeling hopeful about life and you're moving forward. And most people know what it's like to be in anxiety and everything feels different. So the number one goal is to get back in your window. I think that's pretty clear, right? Okay, so how do you do that? So more corny therapy speech that I like. The number one goal, or how you actually get back there, is to be aware of your body and the present moment. So the body is the key to the present. So another thing I learned as a kid was this kind of corny thing that says, yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, today is a gift. That's why it's called the present. Anyone ever heard that before? Okay, I'm going to say it one more time. Yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, today is a gift. That's why it's called the present. So the gift is always in the present moment. And we always hear that our goal is to be more present. And most people are either getting pulled into the past, stuck on what's already happened, or they're anxious about the future. So your job is to kind of be aware of, how do I own and occupy my space in the present and operate from that place? And the body is actually the key to that. Because if you're up spinning in your mind and you're thinking and nonstop ruminating about things, you're not connected to the present moment and you're not connected to your physical body. So your physical body is really a key to do that. So with that, you think of the five senses. Those are kind of keys. Everyone is different for what works for them personally. And so I'm talking to a whole room of people rather than individually talking with each one of you. But basically, think about, so first, sight. Funny images. If you're going into a meeting that's going to be difficult, or you've just got bad news or something, maybe you take out your phone and you have images that just make you laugh, or cute babies or cats or something, where as soon as you look at it, you can't help, it just automatically shifts your brain state. Like, a lot of times it's kind of like when there's too many tabs open on your window, maybe that's just me, but it starts spinning, it gets stuck. It's like sometimes you just have to reset your brain state and you need to do something that you can't think your way out of it, but you have to reset somehow. Even at the beginning, I had you guys do all those fun body movements. That's a different way that changes your brain state. Body movement is a really big thing to change your brain state. So it could be just taking a walk around the block. So with body movement, you can think of temperature. So for some people, they might bring a heating pad in, or if you're in a meeting and you can't have a big heating pad, we have a lot of hand warmers. You could put hand warmers in your shoes or whatever it is. Another thing that also brings calming to the body, I'm going to first teach you the original way, which you probably can't do in public. You can if you want, but it's called butterfly tapping, and that's where you can do it in here, though, where you hook your thumbs, and then you put it here, and you put it on your chest, and then you slowly go back and forth. And this is something, it's kind of similar to deep breathing, where it automatically brings regulation and calming to your body. It's called bilateral stimulation. That's actually why a lot of people get clarity when they go running or walking. It's actually something that connects the hemispheres of your brain, and it moves things out of an emotional brain into the logic and the reason. So you might not be able to do that in the middle of a meeting, but what you could do is intentionally be aware of your feet and just slowly tap them back and forth on the ground. So rather than a restless leg that's going really quickly, you can just slowly tap your feet back and forth. I've actually had a few people I work with try that in the last week in meetings, and they said it really helped a lot. So smell, something like essential oils, I think, are really helpful. So you are agreeing with that? Yes. So this is where it's good to be aware of where you are and where you need to go. So if you're already in a hyper arousal, you probably don't want to use peppermint, because that will maybe kick you up higher. But if you're really low, something like peppermint will kind of bring refreshing and help you. Lavender is something that's really good for calming and bringing it down. If you're already in a hypo shutdown state, it's probably not a good idea to use something about like lavender. So again, that's where it's good to grow in attunement and awareness. What other senses are there? Taste, so it could be like having a hard candy or mint, or even just brushing your teeth in the middle of the day to get a reset. I know I'm missing one. Yeah, breathing, yeah, definitely deep breathing is something that really helps. Sound, thank you. So like calming music is really helpful, or maybe if there's certain music that gets you energized, it's again being aware of yourself and what works for you and how to kind of leverage that. So it depends on the situation. Maybe it's you need it in the middle of your day during a hard work week or before a meeting, or maybe it's something really in life just happened that's really hard and it's totally thrown you out of your window and you have to kind of work your way to get back in. So the other concept, which you kind of mentioned, is self-awareness. So the word I like to use for that is called attunement. And so that's actually it's very similar to mindfulness, but it's how to become attuned to what's happening on the inside of yourself or to others around you. But the key is that it's from a kind and non-judgmental stance towards yourself. So you're just looking at something and being curious about noticing what's happening on the inside. If you start judging or being frustrated that you're frustrated, you'll only knock yourself out of the window and it won't be useful. So the goal is to become aware and just kind of be a student of yourself. It's a new skill, so it's kind of like a baby learning to walk. When babies learn to walk, they fall down over and over again. A good parent doesn't go, "You dumb baby, why'd you fall down?" So falling down is built into the process of learning a new concept. So your goal is almost to be like a kind parent to yourself, where you're just learning and noticing what's happening. So it might be in a situation, you completely react, it puts you in a bad situation with coworkers, you have no idea how it happened or what you did, and then maybe the next time, you just start to notice, okay, when I go into that situation, this is what's happening. You may not be able to stop it at all, you still do the same thing, but then you grew an awareness, like, oh, this is what's happening. And over time, it's almost like a new path lights up, where you always went around the same way every time. It's like a new door appears and you can go a new way. So this is actually huge for the concept of scaling within, because again, if you don't have awareness, you will ensure that you act out of reaction rather than intention. another concept that I think is huge. A lot of times in the business world, maybe in the tech world too, where emotions aren't valued as much. It's just the bottom line and logic and reason. And what's actually interesting is that if you're not informed about your emotions, you will ensure that you react out of them. You'll ensure that you react emotionally, even if you don't think that you are. But if you have awareness of what's happening on the inside, that's actually when you can invite logic and reason and choose a different way. If you don't have awareness, you'll ensure that you're acting out of old patterns. You'll just be like the chicken running around with its head cut off with just the muscle memory of what it used to do. Basically, this is about growing in awareness and also being able to see yourself that where are you in the trajectory, or where's your company in its trajectory? Like, even in a company or a startup, I always think about it with families or kids. The way that you parent a 10-year-old is different than a 2-year-old when you have to do everything for it. What you have to do to a startup to just get by is different than when it's time to put in policies and procedures or to grow that. So if you keep trying to do survival mode when it's a different stage of your company, it's going to kill it. So there also has to be awareness of where am I in this process and how do I need to adapt. So I think about it as being aware and then agile. So I need to have awareness, but then I need to transition or graduate to that next level of being able to operate internally and operate with those around me. Yeah.
And like that, how we respond to that tends to be like, okay, well, given that we aren't going to have that discussion basically, because we're not going to be productive, which is interesting thinking about, you know, what we've been trying to do is, you know, identify your own stress reactions, how you react under stress, and then also modifying and canceling after new meetings if you're not, like ones that can be moved. We haven't talked about how you actually don't have those stress reactions, but just recognizing what those are. And I guess I'm wondering, though, does that happen on both sides? Because if your stress reaction is shut down versus, you know, yell at someone, so is that the same, just kind of it pushes you one direction or the other? And does it happen? I'm thinking of myself and probably which way I go, and I'm thinking I do go both ends, or do we happen to have, do most of us tend one way or the other for like a reaction to our stress?
Sure, I'll try to capture those different things. So, where you work, they kind of refer to it as a stress reaction.
Yeah, it was my team. Yeah,
your team.
Like 4 or 5 of us have been talking about it on our team, and these meetings and how we react.
Yes, it's actually great that you even have that language for it to identify it. So yes, a stress reaction is basically this. So something triggers something, you either get bumped up or you get bumped down. So everyone's different. Some people, their reaction is to go into fight mode, or is to run away, or is the bottom is freeze mode. That's where you're kind of paralyzed or you shut down. So, and you might have your own tendency, but different situations, some people might shut down in some situations, like maybe if they feel intimidated or microaggressions or something like that, that might cause them, or it could also cause them to fight it. So it kind of depends on the person and the situation. So it's actually really good, though, to, if you're aware, you don't want to keep working through that on a team. You don't want to keep working through the conflict, because your starting point determines your end point. If you're starting in your window of tolerance, you can work through it. If you're starting out of there, people can't, you like physically can't access the parts of your brain that you need to for it to make sense. It's not just like we just have to work it through. It's you literally, your adrenaline is pumping, like you literally can't access what you need. So before, people have asked me, well, how would we use that in a meeting? And it depends if you have control over the meeting or not. That helps if you have that. But again, it's to first be aware of where is the room at. Like if it's a lot of tension or people are more in hyperarousal, that's going to be different than if the room is low. So if the room is in hyperarousal, usually everyone can feel when it's tense. Even if people aren't aware that they can, everyone is feeling it. So sometimes even just naming what's going on will diffuse it. When you bring your awareness to something, it automatically begins to change it. That's why attunement is such a big deal, because if you even begin to become attuned to that, you're starting to get out of your window. That alone, just noticing it, can start to re-engage your prefrontal cortex, and sometimes that's just enough to even bring you back in. So sometimes just naming it, or it might be like, let's take a 10-minute break, or so that people can do what they need to do to regulate, or it looks like this is really impacting people, let's get back to this tomorrow, or whatever the situation is. When I think about hypoarousal, I'm also thinking about in a team situation, maybe you've had meetings the whole day, and it's a lot of just heavy, nonstop talking, and people just can't take it anymore, and they're all shutting down. You can only take so much at a time. So that's even where, if you have the flexibility to do this, getting everyone up, doing some of that stuff I had you guys do at the beginning, things like that, movement. Sometimes people have essential oils in the room or just little fidgets or things that help re-engage people's brain state and shift the brain to keep moving forward. Does that cover there?
Yeah,
any?
I think that's helpful.
Okay.
Good question.
Yeah.
Kind of tied into that. So it seems to me that there are some individuals that seem to use having a stress reaction or hyperarousal is actually a method of controlling meetings and things. And so people in a meeting, oh, I guess we can't talk about that, right? Because that's sending this individual off. Does taking a 10-minute outage a break help, or are there other strategies for dealing with situations like that?
Yeah, let me make sure I understand that a little bit more. So you're talking about in a meeting where, well, who is the person? Are they someone leading the meeting, or are they?
Just a participant, team member.
Okay. So there's certain topics that always send that person over the top?
I don't know if it's specific topics, but maybe scenarios, I guess. Yeah.
Okay. So again, it's hard to say without fully knowing it, but maybe that's a situation where, well, let me ask this first. So does that mean that you guys aren't ever able to go forward with the actual needed agenda because you have to cater to that person?
I think as a team, we're not able to move forward to do maybe the job as well as we would like to, because we never get past certain individuals' reactions to things.
So without fully knowing it, what it makes me think of is there ever a time to be able to talk through with that person as a team about, in a non-threatening way, but just kind of naming the dynamics that we want to kind of move forward as a team, and every time we begin to approach these topics, it feels like it brings a reaction, and asking them about what might work for them to be able to move through that.
And so that idea probably sends me into hyperarousal.
That's good. If you want, we can talk more about, because there's so many dynamics of who are the stakeholders, who gets to make the decisions,
sure,
the specific team dynamics. And even sometimes on a team, it's something to figure out, is this something that with work someone can move forward and they can grow in their emotional maturity, or is this ultimately going to be a deal breaker for the team? And that's another question that ultimately comes. Is this something that is going to be for the detriment of this team and what we're trying to do, or is it something that we can grow in? Because eventually, like I said, I don't naturally like conflict, but it's necessary to work through that to have growth. Eventually, that has to come to a head in the team dynamic. So it's how do you want to deal with that? Were you? Yeah, go ahead. Sure. So how do you actually expand your window if you have a small, if you're hardly ever in there? So first, awareness is the biggest thing, because if you're not aware, you can't do anything differently. And that's something that it's not an overnight change. It's a practice where you just begin over time noticing, and even noticing on its own begins to expand that window. It's kind of like you go to the gym, and you've never gone to the gym before, it's really painful at first. And then over time, you build strength. So it's kind of like mental strength training, where you begin to build new neural pathways that allow you to expand that ability to just notice. But what's key is in the process that you're kind towards yourself and that it's a learning curve and that it might take a while, which is hard because most people are very impatient with themselves. And we have a fast culture where we just want things immediately, and that's actually not how most things work. For most things to be done thoroughly and well, it's an ongoing process. So just say a couple more things. So first, it's becoming aware. And then it's figuring out what are the things that work for you to expand your window. So maybe it's something where I'm at work all day, I'm always up in my head thinking about things, and I actually never get physical movement. So I'm going to start doing physical movement or making sure I'm doing something every day to clear my head. Or you have certain things that you're just growing and building over time to expand that. Or it might be something where you just have the same triggers that always come up. And then sometimes that's something where I'm definitely a proponent of therapy or going to actually get work done, because sometimes it's something that's stuck in your brain, like it's a neurological thing or kind of a trigger from the past that you can work through to kind of remove that out of the way and keep moving forward. So just a couple things. But
so just to share a personal experience, so with self-doubt, I actually journal every day and try to think through the moments I had self-doubt, how my brain gets, see if I can figure out the trigger, and then also what did I try to overcome it and how successful it was, and I find that it's really eye-opening, and it's a good way to keep yourself continually working on it.
Okay, so for you it's really helpful to spend the time journaling and kind of tuning into that.
So you're talking about, it's obviously worthwhile to expand this window, so it is a spectrum. There is, you know, percentile place that you could fall on this line, let's say. So what are the pros and cons of being, you know, in the window but at the bottom versus at the top? And is it maybe it's personal preference, like wherever your maximum performance level is. Maybe you always want to be at 95% of the way to hyperarousal, but you do your best there. Are you shooting for the midpoint or?
Sure. So the question is, where do you want to be in your window? Is there kind of a maximal place? I don't fully know the answer to that, but I have some thoughts about it. That's something that I don't know a lot of research about. There actually might be, but I'm kind of playing around with that as I'm bringing this into especially the startup world, because a lot of times people are getting their best stuff done when they're really close up to there, when you're really wanting to act and get things done. And if you're fully in a calm place, you might not be able to function or actually produce a lot or execute. So that's where it's first having that self-awareness and kind of trying that out over time, because there might be kind of cycles or phases where certain times you need to kind of ride that line. But again, it's not helpful to be outside of it, because you can't access the part of your brain that you need. But you might need to just be getting stuff done, and that you're probably going to be up there. But then you might need to take times to then get away or really be calm again. So a lot of times it's also rhythms of life too, where I kind of withdraw and get refilled up, or I get reconnected and clear, or I get the big picture for the company or what I'm doing, and then I kind of come back down and then get a bunch of stuff done. So I don't have a really good answer to that, but it kind of goes back to self-awareness and kind of knowing for you what works best for you and playing around with it, and maybe what's actually needed in the stage of life or the time.
So like if on some day you are thinking, oh, I feel a little anxious today, maybe you don't know a particular reason why, are you too far gone at that point? Like, are you in hyperarousal? Or if your window is expanded, maybe one day when you say you're a little anxious, you're almost there, but if, you know, in a month you've been able to expand it a little bit and now you are within, sort of what, like how does that difference work when it's actually is expanded?
Yeah, if you can recognize that you're feeling anxious, that's actually a really good thing. The awareness is really helpful. So it's not bad that you are, it's more a key to listen. Like our body is actually giving us a lot of information all the time, and most people try to just shove that out of the way. It's kind of like if you have a car and it has a check engine light and you just put duct tape over it to cover it up. Like a lot of times we do that with our emotions or what's going on. Like even an emotion like anger, it's not bad to feel angry. It's actually a signal that something is going on under the hood. This is a little off, but to come back to that, like, anger, for example, is a secondary emotion, which means there's always a primary emotion underneath it. You might feel angry or frustrated, but actually underneath, you're really feeling misunderstood or rejected or lonely. So a lot of times, if you just put duct tape over that, it's not going to be useful, but it's an indicator to look under the hood. So if you can recognize you're anxious, it might be, okay, what's this about? Is this about the meeting coming up? Is this something else going on in life? Because once you're aware of it, you can actually address the underlying cause. I also think about it kind of like sinking sand, which I once heard some quote that growing up that we all thought sinking sand was going to be way more of an issue than it turned out to be in life. But like if you're just walking down the street and you come across sinking sand and you just kind of your ankle goes into it, you can get yourself out. But if you're walking out and you fully go under, you can't get yourself out. So by that I mean if you just kind of go out of your window a little, you can catch that and work your way back in. But if some really difficult life event or big blow comes, it might fully knock you out and you might not be able to get in yourself or right away. And that's where you kind of figure out strategies or get the help around you to get back in. Anything else with that? And then, okay, I'm going to go with you first.
Do you see the connection between scaling within and emotional intelligence?
Definitely. So he asked, is there a connection between scaling within and emotional intelligence? Very much. Basically, this is kind of, do you mean the specific book or just the concept?
Or the concept. We hear a lot about, you know, and navigating turbulence, you know, being a function of emotional intelligence.
Yes.
Going through the ups and downs.
I would say this would actually be a really helpful tool in the toolkit of growing in emotional intelligence. Because a part of being emotionally intelligent is being aware of yourself or others. Because if you're not aware, you'll just react out of the same old patterns that have always happened.
So just, I think you talked about this, just sort of self-care, just basic stuff like eating and sleeping enough. I mean, I personally have seen this, just getting enough sleep has just had a big difference in my day, you know. So I sometimes take that for granted, but it's amazing, just that basic stuff.
Yes. Thanks for adding that. I was going to actually add sleep in when I talked about the different five senses. Sometimes you just need to take a nap and then everything's better or it clicks. So again, first you have to start at the bottom of the pyramid before you work your way up. If you're out of your window, don't figure out your life purpose. It's just time to take care of your physical needs and then you can kind of build that over time. Which is also, this is kind of like scaling within if you're thinking of scaling. Start here and you work your way up. You had a question.
Yeah, we talked a lot about self-awareness to figure out where your window is. But is it possible to figure out how to put your window as far as like where your life or co-workers, where are they?
Yeah, so the question is, we've been talking a lot about our own window, but is it possible to tell if someone else is not in their window? Can anyone else tell if people you know closely are in their window or not? How can you tell?
This gentleman made a comment before about somebody in a meeting saying, crossing their arms and having some sort of negative opinion about the deliverable or something to that effect. You can't do that because so-and-so will say no. And not really in a constructive manner, but rather in a condemning manner. So their body language and that some of the statements that they will indicate. Yeah, very important ones.
Yes.
Oh. One thing, just to the gentleman's point about conflict or somebody being negative, going to take it too much time, but one of the examples from my previous job was Ida Pierce, from the CFO, the CEO, but every meeting that person was very defensive, just could not get through, and then it became emotional, and then became awkward, and then all of us sitting wondering, oh, what do we say, and then I think it went on for a couple of meetings, and I was asked to participate in some of the meetings, and didn't get through, then we realized, I sat there and said, I'm not the person to address it because she sees me more as a peer, and therefore it's better if my CEO addresses it. Well, the CEO basically said, I don't know how to address it, so let's help together. And I think one of the things, as we were talking to that person was, long story sure there were other needs that were not being fulfilled and met. And what it realized was either A, she wanted to be more accepted and felt like nobody was truly listening to her, which, so it was a self-aware, it was a, this was a teaching moment for all of us because we said, okay, why is that person feeling that way? She's a senior executive and she's not being heard. So we needed to be more, correct ourselves to say, why aren't we listening? And then we came to know that a lot of people weren't listening because they just got tired of her defense mechanisms and therefore they just shut off, which meant he didn't listen. So it became this whole cyclical effect. And all of a sudden we started working through a little bit and it hit everybody's awareness individually, taking time and slowing down the meetings. And that really helped.
That's actually really fascinating that you guys were as a team able to work through that.
It was not easy. I mean,
yeah.
But it did help. It eventually did really absolutely.
And that actually sounds like an example where it was worth it to work through it.
Absolutely.
And there could be movement forward versus it coming to a head and
right.
This is not a good fit.
Right.
Sometimes you can't tell that right away. But sometimes it's kind of like a chicken or the egg cycle, which came first. You don't even know how the unhealthy cycle started, but eventually you have to disrupt that somehow and figure out kind of, because people just start triggering each other. Like whichever came first, she felt triggered because she felt misunderstood or not valued, and then her reacting, everyone automatically, they went down probably and went into hypo and shut down. So really good.
So what they did was, I'm assuming you guys recognized that person's needs or what they were doing instead of like in a condescending way of just dismissing the person, like recognizing that there was an underlying issue and treated handle it with respect and dignity, if you will.
Well, you also had strong personalities. Everyone's personalities are different, so we have a lot of strong personalities. Nobody's willing to take the back seat and say, maybe I'm also part of the problem. So that's the other part.
Yeah, so kind of to bring that back to yours, you can very much be aware if people are out of their window, but what's first is actually to be self-aware, because it can be really easy to point the finger, and you're actually completely reacting out at the same time. So once you grow in kind of being able to be calm and operate from that place, then it's a lot easier to begin to make it safe or to name it for other people to look at where they're operating out of and to move forward. Someone up here.
Well, thank you. I don't know how many people here on Scrum team, because that's kind of how I've been thinking about it, the psychological safety, papers that Google's done about the highest functioning teams and having psychological safety, and our teams talk a lot about that, about how you foster psychological safety so people can dissent comfortably and, share needs, and I think a lot of that has come to people talking about even, what time do we have meetings? Like, okay, we shouldn't have meetings in the afternoon because we're more likely to have those stress reactions, or, if this is something, and Bill will laugh, because I bring candy to every meeting, and it's little, but, like, somebody who's tired and hungry, like, they have two Reese's cups, and all of a sudden, like, the tone of the meeting changes.
Yep.
But I think it has allowed us all to be more comfortable sharing about, we have one coworker's like, I can't do more than 50 minutes and I need a break or else they shut down. And us talking about that with one another to kind of figure out what our optimized environment is for having meetings so we can be productive.
Yeah.
That's good. And I'll say one more thing and then we have to wrap up and then maybe you can ask me after that question. But something that I've kind of brought in even to working with teams that comes from the marriage and family therapy realm is to be a healthy parent, you need high warmth and high structure. Like if you have the warmth and compassion but no structure, it's not helpful. If you have the structure but not the warmth, it's not helpful. So even in meetings, being aware of if it's just about the bottom line, but it's not emotionally safe in the room, people will shut down and you won't get anything from them. So the window is also key. If you want to access flow, if you want to access creativity and productivity, that all flows from being in the present and actually being able to access the core of you and to be able to access the best of the people around you. So being emotionally safe is a really key thing to do that and having both the warmth and the structure. So thank you everybody for coming. If you have any questions, feel free to stop by. I also have cards if you want.